thank you very much, Marion, for asking me to come along today.
I wanted to say that I think there's some great symmetry in the fact that we're in the Liz Ellis room today. So for those of you who don't know Liz Ellis, she's an absolute champion of Australian football. She played for 18 years consecutively, and she was in four world champions, world championships, and two Commonwealth Games. And poignantly as well, she's had a knee reconstruction from an ACL injury too, which is kind of my catalyst. I'll tell you a little bit more about where I've come from and why I've developed this particular program. So yeah, I'm glad to be in this room as such. I was very surprised that we found out about me because I must admit I wanted to clarify with her that I was a netball physio and I didn't really know anything much about badminton, but I've since learned that you're very smart and well informed, and there are actually quite a few similarities from what I'm presenting some of the riskier movements that you come on.
I was quite on netball there, so.
Were you? So I want to challenge you because I'm not going to. The two disclaimers is I'm not a coach, so I'm talking to a room of coaches, and I'm not trying to tell you as coaches what to do. I'm better than that, and I'm also no expert in badminton.
Nor are we.
So what I want to challenge you to do is when I'm presenting this stuff, which is very netball, because it's a netball specific program, I'd like you to try and draw out from it for me, for my benefit, and for your benefit, what's going to be useful for you on the court. So I think that's why I'm here. Otherwise, I might as well go home now. So what I am going to start by doing is just asking a few questions of you as coaches. Would you like to have a full set of options in terms of your players, and some that are not restricted? You know, you like that one, but they're injured or they're restricted. Would you like to have a full list of people to choose from?
Yes.
And would you like to see them playing to their capacity when they're on court? So you look at them and you think, oh, I just wish they could get, just stride that bit further or jump that bit higher. You know, again, I'd say most people would want to have them playing to their capacity on court. And I think for me, one of the biggest drivers, I pose it to you, is do you want longevity for your players? If you finally get a player that's excellent, do you want them to be able to keep going and keep going and keep going? And I'd suggest perhaps the answer is yes to that as well. And for me, that's the catalyst, that's the aim of the knee program. As a physio, I am particularly passionate about players retiring from the sport because they want to, not because they're broken. And too often they're broken. And the classic example is the absolute gladiator, Julia Coletto, who won the World Champion of the World Cup last year here in Sydney. She played the final quarter of netball with a broken foot. And she played with a broken foot. And she knew it was broken, but she knew she was retiring from sport. And it was just a matter of us kind of banding, you know, copying it together to try and get through the last 15 minutes on court. But my aim is that she decides to retire because she's just had enough of the day, and not because she's broken off.
Is that interesting? That's quite an interesting issue to you in relation to actually her well-being. Yeah. Who's ultimately responsible for it? So
absolutely.
If she aggravated it.
Yep. So she had, we can talk about it retrospectively, she had a stress reaction in her foot that we were managing for the 6 weeks leading up into the World Cup. So she was basically away from the cameras, she was 100% in the boot in the cameras. It was what we needed to present. She was not on call at all, and she then started just doing very minimal impact just in the days leading up to the thing. It was a very well-informed decision, and there were many discussions about it as well. But she was very open about the fact that she was retiring and was Australian soil, and she accepted the risk and wanted to do what we predicted would happen, which was that the bone would actually break. It was a toe bone through here. But you know, to be able to jump and land and rebound for 15 minutes against a silver fence.
So you always have big kids.
We have already found
the solution for the netball problems in New Zealand.
Just now.
All of them are going to play basketball, and the basketball problem will be so strong. But that's not fun.
So today, I wanted to just give you a little bit of an introduction.
introduction to netball for those who don't know too much about it and why I've actually gone on to this. Just talk to these two.
The rest of us, we know it. Let's just do it.
To just tell a little bit about the injury challenges that we have as a sport, and I think there are some similarities there, some of the physical requirements on court, and the process in terms of how this knee program came about, which was quite a three-year process. And then I wanted to run through the specifics of the program and if some of you were game to try and actually do some of the drills and challenge you as to how you would tweak these particular exercises for badminton. Hopefully we'll come up with something pretty good. So to start off with netball, there's 1.2 million participants nationally each year in Australia, so it's massive. It's the number one female sport for women and for girls. And there's over 5,000 clubs in Australia and 730 associations. No existing injury prevention program in place though until now. It's a non-contact sport, you know, it's really soft, isn't it? For that non-contact, there's really a fair amount of physicality that is involved with that. And I think as the game has got faster, the laws have changed. It certainly has got even more physical. And I think traditionally we haven't been prepared in our training methods for that physicality. And I think that's the key. It's actually trying to...
Who started it?
Pardon?
Who started it?
The
physicality.
I don't know. I think it just got stronger. The athletes got,
bigger, taller.
Exactly. They're more hungry. They're able to get the hard balls, and I think it's really more to do with that, just the development of the game. In terms of what happens on netball, for those who may not know, but some people are restricted to a third. Some are restricted to the middle third and the final. There's three portions on the court. There's one position that can go everywhere except in the goal area, and there are a couple that can go in two thirds. So there's rules and restrictions about where you can go. You're not allowed to take an additional step when you land, so you can't say, I think it's European handball or...
Three steps.
It makes it much safer if you can take an additional step. You can't take an additional step. The best you can do is kind of go back and come up, but you can't take another step and lift off the back foot.
So if it's similar to basketball?
Basketball, you can do whatever you like.
You can catch and dribble.
Yeah. And therefore you have to physically catch the ball and stop. And I think as well, I was going to talk about just the change in rules. The game's got faster, so there's big demand for what we call transition, where the ball's coming down the court, and the ball's coming this way. And a lot of the players now, rather than kind of catching it and turning, they tend to catch and rotate mid-air. So they're rotating mid-air and landing, or they've got that rotational force, but it's not doing a lot for when they land. So I don't know how that relates to badminton, but that's what happens in football. I've done some research in the last week. and this is just a couple of things that I've noted about the demands of badminton. So jumping, turning, speed off the mark, lateral movements and agility are extremely important. Would you agree with that?
Sure.
Yep. And do you think in the training methods that you're sufficiently prepared for that? Just a question. Perhaps?
At a high level, I guess you know how like with Esther, but more with high, there's more... preventive work going on in the gym, but we all know that usually that stuff, a lot of people don't do that until they had an injury and then the program starts to kick into place.
But even, I guess, even before you play, so if you're in your warm-up, for instance, prior to going on court as well, I think that's where I come from, is definitely gym program critical, but wondering whether there's enough in your warm-up, whether you get to enough intensity to actually prepare you for what's on court as well. I don't know. Moving on to injuries. So there's a 4% risk of injury for anyone, any sport, just got walking on the court. That's just a given. With netball, the major injuries for us, so 85% of our injuries come from the lower limb. So the orange bit there is knees, which is 45%, and ankles, which is 40%. Knees are usually the main ligaments that go, but certainly some overuse injuries in terms of patellar tendon issues. Cartilage issues as well, and ankles, predominantly ankle sprains on landing. quite a significant portion of our injuries relate to lower limb. 85% of ankle injuries occur on my knees, and the majority of knee injuries also occur on my knees. So it's for us, for me, it's like landing is the key. We've got a nail landing.
I'd say this is very similar to Bevan, with Bevan adding the shoulder and back.
Yes. Elbow or not?
Shoulder is big. Yeah. Rotated calf, yeah. Shoulder.
Yeah. So that's what I've tried to look up a few articles on recently. What I've found is three times as frequent overuse injuries as chronic.
Yeah.
As acute. Would that be right in terms of patella tendon, Achilles tendon, just niggly things that, as opposed to the catastrophic acute injuries? That correct? That's what it says, but I don't know if that's right. That was the Miyake 2016. Of the acute injuries, you're more likely to get ankle sprains and muscle strains to the lower limb. So that's obviously not quite correct in terms of shoulders. Females had a much higher rate of injury in practice, 30 runs, as opposed to matches, but practice was the highest risk zone for females. And then in adolescents, so the adolescent age group, mainly soft tissue injuries and mainly the lower limb. And they were the most frequently injured group of the sample that was taken. In terms of mechanism of injury for netballers, so RDN, our main killer, is landing. 46% of injuries occur on landing in the grey area, and the others are on running and collisions with other players are the main big ones. From what I can see, and again, please correct me if I'm wrong, the main mechanism of injury, from what I would imagine, would be the outstretch. That's a horrible position here. How do you pick up a ball and then the ankles are just kind of inverting?
That is bad football.
Yeah.
I don't know how the ankle remains intact. And the lateral movements, obviously here, like that's the ankle sprain there, just as kind of a sideways movements, but a lot of the running, jumping and landing, so whether that's overuse injuries or the acute injuries. Is that correct? Or have I got that right?
Yeah. I mean, the acute ones, well, I was like, obviously, you know, the video you see, I think the acute, this landing is the horrible, whether it's a lunge or from jumping,
it's
but also the rotation and twisting is also one that often happens, especially where you're trying to twist, you're trying to rotate, but your foot is somehow not, the knee or ankle is not, especially knee, back.
I'm really interested in the practice.
Add on to it. I'm currently doing the research on the lunges and stuff. I did my master's in neuromuscular fatigue in badminton and came out that lunges itself, actually, it's very, very fatiguing. All right, it has been shown that in the game of high level, elite level, international levels itself, males are executing up to 400 lunges. That is inclusive half lunges and full lunges itself in the game, just in one game. And the thing is that it's all about overuse and fatigue, in the sense that the neuromuscular fatigue also comes into play, whereby your body reacts to it, but your leg muscles do not allow you to do it. And that's where you get the awkward twist and things like that. So it is very much a whole body kind of mechanism, and we need to learn more about it. And we need to kind of like, I can only say that we really need to have a better understanding of not just in the training part, but how can we help in making the player aware of this situation, because to them they would just be like, why are you training me and doing all the lunges? But then when they actually suffer from that, they would say that I have not been doing enough of that practice.
Arguably, Australia's most decorated badminton player in her ACL.
Do you get a lot of patella tendon issues?
Achilles, huge problem. Had one last week. Okay. 2 weeks in a row, we had one just went fully. But it tends to happen a lot more in the older,
The
patella. I don't know. I tend to have experienced that the
the players tend to build a muscle not proportional to the inside and outside,
yeah.
especially in badminton.
Yeah.
So maybe in our training, you should study that in the genes or the genes.
Very
yeah.
valid point, yeah. I mean, I think for me, what you're saying, I think you need enough stimulus to the tendon.
Yeah.
Tendon responds to load,
yeah.
so it responds to excessive load, it responds to unload. But you need to periodise the load, and that involves your strength conditioning work and your game time. High load of tendon, it actually takes the tendon physiologically 72 hours to recover from one burst of high load. So if you're doing repeated court works, you are stressing that. So if you can periodise your training, you know you've got your priority sessions and you've got a bit of space in between them, then that's going to be great for the long term. And I understand that that's sometimes not possible, but certainly in the netball periodisation, we've very much taken that into account. Because we have to stop suddenly, we have a lot of tendon issues as well. And then with, what was the other point I was going to say? It's gone out of my mind.
The other thing that's often overlooked, strange enough, in the UK, the number one cause of eye injuries is badminton.
Oh.
Really?
Yeah.
So you can get central lines.
Probably my injury is basically in the inner lower back.
Yeah.
Because that's actually your plunder head.
That's
what you've got no advantage to it. You usually your effect is fast enough to avoid.
Yes.
But most of it might be in the middle and lower.
Okay.
And you turn around, someone gets straight with the arm.
Did anyone see Yanni Jorgensen almost losing his mind?
Definitely.
Yeah. Just ask me about the arguments. Is that the weight contribution or not?
The which?
Your body weight.
ACL risk there is to do with body mass index.
Is it possibly correct or not if I'm treating someone when I said to her or him, you have to lose weight?
I would calculate body mass index, so body height, body weight, and get a number rather than saying that you need to lose weight. I think it's the way you sell it, could be particularly with impressionable
people. Especially with two.
So
because I'm a man, I won't tell you, and then come on, you have to lose 55 kilo weight, but for girls or 15 years old girls having injury, you know,
Yeah, I would get them to calculate, so you can Google the body mass index in terms of how to do the calculation. You get a number, and then you've got in that, you've got an average, you've got a below average, and you've got an above
because
average.
Because if you're not honest, you can be not honest and wrong, but it's like that it definitely all things.
It doesn't look just. There are many, I'm getting to that. So back to ACL, for those of you who don't know, anterior cruciate is probably the most catastrophic to injure. It takes the longest period of time to actually rehabilitate from. It was a quarter of injuries reported for netball from 2010 to 2014. And actually last year the incidence of ACL injuries was 33%. So it's huge. Huge costs associated with ACL injuries, obviously the time away from the sport, within that time someone else slots into your position and your rate of compression is slowed. It's a huge financial cost. So you've done your ACL?
No, my
bypass
had just removed, so that's
something.
You
have?
I did my ACL, yeah.
And has anyone had a player that has done?
My son's a good girl.
Yeah?
I don't have
ACL. ACL? Not ACL?
No.
So
I
eight,
don't
one,
have ACL.
Two?
Sounds
three.
It was a partial tear.
Very unusual, but yeah. So, did you return to the same level of competition after you did your ACL? Sorry,
yeah.
It's a very personal question, but.
Yeah, sort of.
Yeah?
Not quite, but.
Not
just
quite?
Yeah.
I
returned
at a higher
level.
Then into it
again.
Okay.
Training
yourself. Obviously, you're not. Statistics because 65% of people who do their ACLs don't return to sport at all, and many of them, so it's 65% don't return to sport at all, and of those that do return, most of them are at a reduced level of eliteness. So it's a huge problem in terms of, like, if it's 33% of injuries for netballs for us, it's a huge problem for us all. And the other major thing is that if you had cartilage damage when you did it, break it to you, but within 20 years of that, you will have arthritis. So it's the long-term consequence of it as well.
Jesus.
Sorry.
Is there in netball a lot of, what's the percentage versus dominant?
Yeah, I don't know that. We don't have the statistics on that, and I'd love to know that, because I know that Marion was saying most of it's the non-dominant league that you do.
No, is it?
Mm. Well,
depending on
recall
or
frontal.
I think it's the non-dominant league. Because they're so asymmetric.
Yeah.
Like if you split somebody in half, and that becomes a right job together in terms of looking at whether, let's say they're right-handed,
yeah,
and how developed and yes, if you measure the diamond and stuff like that, oh, well, it's just crazy how much the difference is.
Yeah, that's a big problem.
If even from playing now, if I look at my right wrist versus left, and I haven't played, but I don't play it. Yeah, that frequency anymore for what? How many? 12 years. The right wrist compared to the left.
Bone development.
Just strengthen it because it's crazy.
I think I've recently developed a screen for netball as well, and the focus on the screen is on limb symmetry. So yes, trying to achieve not necessarily markers as such, but limb symmetry is the key. And the other thing is the social cost of it as well, which is kind of what that picture's up there. You miss opportunities while you're rehabbing. Risk factors, it's not just body mass index, that is one of them, but females, we've got a 4 to 6 times higher chance of doing our ACL just because we're female, for a range of different reasons.
Is that structural?
We've got smaller ACLs with reduced tensile strength, but we've also got hormonal factors, so we're actually more at risk in our premenstrual phase as opposed to postmenstrual. NNC, so neuromuscular control is a really big one. And anyone who has reduced neuromuscular control is at higher risk. But females are at higher risk because we land in mechanics that are at a higher risk than males. One of the other reasons.
Neuromuscular control, is that just...
It's your muscles, landing in a way that is not ligament dominant, it's more muscle dominant. So you're using your muscles and your brain is actually effectively switching on your muscles to
work. Ah, okay, so it's cognitive control of what you're doing.
Yes, and it's training, that awareness. So there's one thing that's called proprioception, which is your awareness of your position. So if I had my arm up here, if I've got good proprioception, I know my arm's up there. If I've got bad proprioception, I can say my arm's down here. That's kind of your awareness of the position, and neuromuscular control is your ability to actually influence or control how your muscles recruit when you're landing in movement.
So it's like your brain saying, oh, I see a flat right come straight. So your reaction is that I want to block it straight, so your arms come straight up. So it is like the split second of your brain trying to get to your arms, get to your whole system and say, I just want to block it. Mm-hmm. But then if you kind of like look at it and say, oh, it's going to be a flat drive flying fast, but I don't have that kind of reaction to reach it, then say, I need to move my leg first. You say, I need to move my leg at the same time my hand. So that's where that split second is very crucial. How good your activation of your neuromuscular control from your brain to your spine, to your nerve, down to the muscles, and down to the finger, the fine motor itself can be different.
And is that something that is, I don't want to say fixed, because I know nothing's fixed, but is that easy to overcome through training?
You can train it.
So that's the idea, if you're wanting to increase your neuromotor control.
Yeah.
Good question.
It all turned out to be muscle memory.
I guess.
But to be honest, when it comes down to that, it would not be really muscle memory because you will still have to activate it.
Mm.
When it comes to it, it is still your nerve system, which is your spine, controls it to get your muscles activated.
So for me, an example would be, when you land, as females typically land more upright, like that, which is very limber dominant if you're in that position. But if you can land further back, like that, it's switching on your glutes, switching on your hammy, so you're adapting to become more muscle dominant. You're using more neurological control of that.
Okay, and that goes through your system,
right? Yeah, so I don't know what the specific is, but that would be how I'd interpret that. Post-puberty is probably the highest risk, females post-puberty, so greater over 16. The valgus moment, so the inward knee position is greatest at the age of 16, and it's that is the critical age in terms of highest risk.
You heard that, gentlemen? Those with young daughters?
Mine's 8, so I don't know.
Yeah,
5 years away from 7.
Sorry,
his is 15, so he's...
I can't play next year.
For us, it's the ones that look like giraffes, so they're just really incoordinated in terms of having growth spurts, where your muscle and your bone growth are not. So the ones that look like they're awkward on court, and the ones that really don't have that motor control aspect, and they are the ones
that you might answer this, but if we can identify young athletes that are that giraffe type, you know, not necessarily
giraffe
type. It's an easy way to identify it. Yes, you can all think of someone who's a bit too long.
I use the word first.
I was just repeating sound medical advice. Is there altered training that they undertake? Is it the same training reduced?
I think it's a matter of screening those individuals. They might be giraffes, but they might be actually pretty good. They might have limb symmetry. They might have equal. They might
pick the axles.
Do you have someone? Do you have people that are affiliated? So yeah. So whoever it is, that whether it's the institutes or I would be directing them to the physio staff that you have working with you, or.
Mm. I would be concerned at a club level. There's not, like, again, fortunate in Ballarat, we have Federation University affiliated with our club, and we do get screening for athletes. But I know there's plenty of Melbourne-based academies who, they would not have any affiliation with a physio or sports physiologist or any.
The key is, like, here is this for you. I mean, you're 100% involved with netball.
Yep.
And it's a very professional setup, so you've got.
Very fortunate, yeah.
I can't, for example, in New Zealand, think of anybody who's, for example, full time just looking after badminton. So when you want to set up this time programs, you need people who are dedicated and, like yourself, setting up whether it's a knee program or something, a screening program.
Is there a physio that works with the top Australian team?
One performance team works with the VIS. Because it would be interesting to see whether you could pitch to the VIS for them to develop some sort of badminton-specific type screen, if they work with a lot of badminton athletes. And that's what we've done with netball, is we've got a screen together over the last, 8 months or so. And it's now pretty accessible to anyone nationally. So that, and if you target the right tests on the screen, then you can pick up the deficiencies you need, rather than it being this kind of expansive system. One other thing I just wanted to mention to you, I don't know whether it is relevant for you guys, but the shoe-surface interface is a really interesting risk factor. There was a study done that showed a 5-day tournament, and it tracked the number of injuries sustained versus the age of the shoes that were worn, and they showed that over 50% of injuries occurred in shoes that were brand new, not worn.
Yeah.
And that's to do with the frictional properties between the surface of the shoe and the actual shoe itself. And one of the major traditions with netballers is that your mum sets you off to nationals with a brand new pair of shoes. So you're throwing them into the high-risk environment anyway in terms of loading, increased intensity, and then you put onto it a brand new pair of shoes. So I'm not saying don't wear your shoes, but certainly to kind of wear in your shoes. I don't know what the shoes are, but wear them in somehow rather than going into high.
Particularly girls in badminton will play in their full shoes. Yeah. Like ASICs or yeah. this?
They're quite good, they've got a pure point, but they are quite.
I love ASICs too. I love ASICs. Yeah. But I'm just saying, as particularly girls, I've noticed they're often in ASICs footwear, or there is Yonex and Leaning and specific providers as well, just for your Yonex too.
So long as they're wearing them in, they're actually quite an issue. I know I'm talking a lot about ACLs, but it's there's a point to it all. The main mechanism of doing your ACL is in landing, change of direction, and deceleration. So it's really important that that's a risk factor regardless of technique, but we really want to optimise technique. In sports that involve abrupt landing, deceleration, and change of direction, you are at a higher risk, and I'd say that that would fall into the category. There are two ways that you can do your ACL, either through direct contact or indirect contact. So direct contact is when you get tackled around your legs. Doesn't really happen too often anymore. Or there's non-contact. And with non-contact, so it's either when, as I mentioned before, the two classic mechanisms. The first one is in transition, so when they're kind of coming down the court and they rotate mid-air. That's the classic. There's no one around them. But it's that rotation force through the trunk which actually causes their knee to turn inwards and like that fantastic video that you just showed. I've got some more coming, so that'll wake everyone up. And then the other one is what we call indirect contact, which is where in netball is where they're going for a ball and they get a knock from their partner. So they've got to kind of react within a millisecond to actually control. They have a good, nice planned landing with it. Get a shunt and they have to try and adjust it down on that.
How much difference is it in the people that are injured by the high knee mobile?
It actually isn't equated as a risk factor. I do find it hard to believe, but yeah, it just hasn't come up as much in my mobility,
Because there's a slight delay, isn't
there? But I'd say it's to do with neuromuscular control, and you don't want to land in that hyperextended position, So if you look at this landing here, this is a high risk single leg landing. So it's firstly single leg, which is I think what you do most of the time with badminton, or not?
Well, I've seen, especially a rotator, if you're just jumping backwards, I mean even though it's it is a single leg.
Yeah, and that happens a lot in netball as well. They don't tend to land like that, they will put the other foot down.
It also depends how far you get overplayed, whether how quick that is. It could be that if you get stretched out really far, there's a lot more pressure and the time that you're actually on one leg is longer than when you're obviously in control.
Valve's knee, so that's that inward knee position, which we saw on the video. Trunk sway, it's a really big one where you're landing and your trunk's off like that. It's probably even not as relevant as the knee position, it's your trunk. Hip abduction of the free leg, which is here with Shani. Shani's on the billboard out front, she's an absolute superstar. But that position there, inadequate hip and knee bend to absorb that load, and external rotation of the foot. So the reason why that's important is that your knee position relative to your foot then becomes very skew-whiff. So if you rather than landing like this, if you're like that. So I want to show you a couple of things. I just want to put you look at that and see if that looks a little familiar to the previous. I think it really is quite similar in terms of what is required. But bear with me now while I just show you a couple of videos.
Disclaimer, is there going to be twisting here? Because I'm not interested.
Yeah, there is.
My shots actually have their career ended because of the knee injury. Would understand.
Yeah, if you'd like to go to your happy place or you'd like to leave the room, it's absolutely fine.
My happy place is my
but for the benefit of the others in the room, I would like to show you just a few things. So there's a couple to show you with netball in terms of how it happens, and you'll see it's the girl in pink at the next after the next centre pass, the top of the screen, top left now. Okay, so it's just a little, it looks relatively innocuous, it's just a little knock at the air and it's just destabilizing. What's happened there, you can see the external rotation of the foot there and the knee turning inwards.
Close up?
No, don't worry. This one is the rotation I was talking about in court, so there's no one around her. This is great. So. think, and then there is a slime right here, which is why I've kept it.
Essex.
They were new.
Look at this. So, it's the girl at the back, top of the court.
Right here.
Yeah, the girl next ball down, next one. Pretty impressive, that one. Sorry. So it's that trunk position I'm really interested in. I think the trunk's probably more so that trunk. And then that's
mostly overhead.
No, it's not. It's doesn't have a normal, you know?
They've got to get a little backhand.
This is a... It's not very this... It's the same thing. It's the same mechanism. It's just that. And I think for me, we'll come back to it. That's a change of direction. It's not just landing. It's how...
That's a lot of...
I didn't go a bit fully.
Sorry.
Yeah. Pain.
The catalyst for this for me was actually we had a run of, we had 7 ACLs in one pathway, so 7 to 17, 19 age group. And that was able to raise eyebrows, so I was able to make a pitch from that. But it's something we've known about for a while. So in order to develop this, I needed to identify how big the issue was, which I managed to do, and some facts just about injury mechanism and all that. I pitched Netball Australia, they came to the party, I went to the AAS, and they came to the party in terms of being able to develop it as an online resource, and that's what is different about this. It's accessible via smartphones. If you're interested, you could do it now. And the reason for the digital component was just to make it more broadly accessible for people who are wherever they are in the country. And I guess then I had to start to get some evidence as to the programs that were effective, and there was nothing in netball, but there's plenty that's been done in other sports. So FIFA 11 is an excellent example. It's a PEP program as well, but there were also some others. It's a European handball, Golden Goals, over in Norway. It's done a huge amount of really good work. And all of these programs, what was interesting about them was that it certainly reduced ACL injuries, but it reduced lower limb injury risk in general. And that's the take-home message. I'm talking a lot about ACLs because it's a problem with us, but I expect to see it actually reduce the rate of lower limb injuries in general. And that's what's been shown to happen. And it reduces the rate of injury from anywhere from 40 to 70% if they're done. So, these are the thank yous. I have to thank these people because the program wouldn't be here without it. Netball Australia, Institute of Sport, Netball New South Wales and Victoria, who guinea pigged so many athletes on this over the last few years and changed the program just depending on feedback. And a few other people here who've been instrumental in getting it going. So, it is an injury prevention program, but it's also designed to enhance the way you move. So it's a movement efficiency program, and I think that is actually one of the really key points in terms of trying to get buy-in, is to, you know, people ask glaze over sometimes in terms of injuries, oh, it won't happen to me, but if it's going to improve how you move on court, then someone's going to listen to you more, and I think that's an interesting thing if you're trying to actually get this implemented wherever you are, that it does improve the way you land, you change direction, and you speed off the mark as a result of that. The program has been divided into 3 different levels, and so it works similarly, I guess, in your structure, but there's a junior program which is designed just for the young ones, so 10 to 14 year olds, and the reason why it's different is that they're on growing bodies, so it's really more to do basic physical competency and just getting movement patterns going without it being too fancy. The worst thing you can do is just reinforce an error. So we're trying to really break it down to the more simple movements and get them doing that right first. The recreational program is more for just your everyday midweek midweek play or a Saturday afternoon mum who's escaping the kids on a rainy afternoon or something like that. So it's safe to be used for anyone. And then the Elite program is really designed for enhancing the movement efficiency and how you actually transition into the next movement. So they are tailored differently for each group.
Can we get access to this?
Yeah, it's online. It's freely accessible now. Yep.
And that's just at the website?
It's knee.netball.com.au. And I'll take you through it soon. But yeah, and yeah, encouraging a little bit. I think there'll be a fair bit in it that's useful. So the take home is it's a warm-up program, it's a court-side warm-up program, and the reason why we've done that is that it enhances implementation. If you pitch something as a program that's going to be a bolt-on to your training, it just won't get done. It might get done for a few weeks, but then, you know, there'll be not enough time or there'll be some other priority or some other skill that you need to learn. But whatever your current warm-up is, my pitch was to actually change it to this because it involves a lot of what they will do, but it's actually got evidence behind it. So that's what if you were to try and adopt some of this, I would try and incorporate some of it into whatever warm-up you do prior to actually hitting the court. And there are many components to it. It's very adaptable. It's not meant to be a recipe that you follow, but there's a whole list of different exercises in there from which you just choose a few. And I'll go into why that's important soon. So this is the program. I want to take you through it because it's easier just to... Yep. So this is the homepage. Across the top, it's got a little bit about the program and then it's divided into each of these different resources. And if you go into the About page, it has these key principles that I'm about to go through. And a lot of it is about how to take off, how to land, how to change direction, and how to decelerate. And there's a whole lot of different things that are superimposed on top of it. If you go into a level, so say we do the junior, down the bottom here, you have a one-page little sheet, which is a printout, that has a whole range of different exercises that you can choose from, with the specifics of what you need to do. And if you prefer, you can go into, I won't click on that, that's a manual, which is literally about a 20-page manual, which breaks down every single exercise and exactly how you need to instruct it. And if you go into each of these sections across the bottom, we've got a video that comes up. So there should be no, no issues in interpreting what you're meant to do and what is good technique. It's got a voiceover as well, which hasn't really come up, but that's just a basic junior exercise, which is a bridge to try and enhance some glute by exercise. So, it certainly felt like we've tried to make it as comprehensive as possible to actually allow it to be easier used. For instance, here is just a ball roll exercise. That would have for us. I don't know how that went for you. And that's just to enhance. I'll go through it, but yeah, I guess the take-home message is that there's a lot on there, so feel free to have a look and see what you can draw from if it's relevant. The key principles in the program. I'll just use it from this slide for the moment, because I'm about to drop out of it. As I said, it's takeoff and landing. When you're doing takeoff, you want to make sure that your feet are straight in principle. And I don't know how you adapt it, but in principle, feet shoulder width apart, so not too wide. Your feet facing forwards, not rotated out. Your hips bent and your knees bent. And the classic thing, if I have someone who would love to help me this afternoon,
Carl,
please. Thank you.
He's a croc, but don't worry.
That's even better. Come over here. It's like you said, jump. Just jump and land.
Yeah,
not too
hot.
Just jump.
Right,
yeah. Okay. Good. And what I want you to do now is to jump without bending your knees. And can you see? It's a silly example, but if you don't take off well, you're not going to land well. And everyone talks about landing, but no one actually talks about taking off. So a skill to learn is actually how to take off as well. And you did it beautifully the first time. So if you can go to take off and pause at the point just before you get air, stop. Yes, Okay. So we look at, can you see this foot here rotated out? You can see it. So it needs to be ideally, and what then happens there is that knee then goes inwards of your foot. So you're wanting this nice position here where your knees are tracking in line with your feet, not like that. And you'll see already there's a preference to be on one leg is better aligned and the other is not so aligned.
Guess which
one
you think about.
Okay. And you're wanting your feet kind of shoulder width apart. And again, I think that's a real challenge with badminton because see how wide your legs are in terms of your takeoff stance. So I'm not suggesting you change that, but I'm suggesting that when you're doing it, that you make sure that their knees are wide enough relative to their feet.
Nobody likes to get up, obviously.
So takeoff position, feet shoulder width apart, this is ideal. And what I'd suggest you do is that you practice it, but even though you know they're not going to do it exactly like that, you're getting the motor connection going in the brain, you're waking it up, this is what I want to be doing, I want to be switching on, and the reason why you want to bend your hips so much is you're switching on your glutes all the way through range, switching on, they come now, they're a hip extender, so they work from here all the way up, and all the way back to landing again.
So
the more bend you get at takeoff, the more control you get at landing.
That's the neuromuscular connection.
Exactly. That's the ligament. That's not right, but it's just kind of getting some frequency involved in. Okay, I can actually switch on muscles and take off better as well as landing better. Yeah, that's good. Then I was going to show. Oh, yeah, I've got this little video actually.
I'll come back
to that video because we're on a bit of a roll here, but so the landing is a similar principle to the takeoff, exactly the same kind of mechanism. We're just trying to absorb that landing. And if you're doing it on one leg, you're really looking for whether your hip drops down, so you don't want to be doing. Oh, I should get you to do it, sorry. So just jump and land on one leg for me. So you can jump off both and then land on one and hold it.
As in?
And hold the position that you land in. The knee is relatively well in line and the hips are relatively level. So what the classic you'll see in someone, can you do it on your injured leg or is that too sore?
No.
Are you really injured?
No. Yeah, I have a missing part of my toe.
Okay.
No.
Do you, it's not something you usually do. That's what you'll see. You see the hip drop, for instance, or the knee go in like that. And you would have that, but I don't know. I don't really want to hurt you. And I'll show you these three clips in a minute. Deceleration, I think that's probably not quite as relevant for you because I think you do too much just lunging. I don't know. Correct me if I'm wrong.
It just seems to be such a small space. You can't allow deceleration.
Yeah. And the classic, so what you're meant to do with deceleration is to take, I usually get people to do it, but I won't if it's a slow one. You accelerate and then stop, okay? And most people will go out hard and literally just stop like that. And that's just horrible for the knee. So what you want to be doing is you want to be taking multiple steps to decelerate. And I don't know how that applies again.
We did a bit of that this morning with Brendan doing the running steps, and then we tried to alter the way he stopped by adding that hop, skip, and then stop rather than run.
But at the end of the day, we conclude, like we get full pace and then stop. You have to get the shuttle as quick as you can, and then you can't afford to hit and keep moving in that direction.
And there's no off-ball work, is there? You're kind of always going to, like, for netballers,
there's no off-ball.
No.
Okay.
Oh, unless you're a doubles pair, I guess.
it's worth knowing, and we'll do it on the course, but it's worth knowing that the method of decelerating that is highest risk is that sudden single, and not only just for ACL but for patella issues. Oof, it's a highlight on your patella. Mm-hmm. And that's what I was thinking with deceleration. You know, you don't really tend to do lots of little stops. My take-home message with that would be: if you can't actually do multiple steps, just make sure their alignment is good when they're actually stopping.
Absolutely.
And that's good alignment there. Yeah? That's pretty, it's quite nice.
Can I use with that one to get direction, you can reach further. See, this one you can't reach further.
Right.
See,
but
this
yes.
one gets tough, but this one you can reach
further. So there's going to be
instances. There's a technique that they use in the
morning. It's like with that landing I showed you before, Shani, who's, you know, she's in starting seven in Australia, she's an excellent player. She's still going to do some landings that are high risk. Just is the nature of the sport, it's the nature of what we're in, you're pushing that every percent. So it's going to happen, but if you know that the, what the movements are that are, you know, less risky, then that's a better thing. Yeah. Were you asking something?
I was going to ask something because, like, his hips for me
yeah.
in that photo
yeah.
would be a big problem because of
the. Yeah, it's, I mean, look, I think it's the difficulty is that it's where his back foot is, it's probably on a huge amount of stretch as well. So it's very hard to control your hip position when you're that far out, it's going to drop down a bit. But yeah, if you can reinforce in terms of alignment in practice.
Because like just about every coach that I've ever met around the world coaches a lunge like this.
Right.
We never lunge like this.
Yeah.
We never practice lunge. And what I've been getting my athletes to do, at least the ones that are going for Olympics and something high level, is actually bring in where the hips are
yeah.
in some way.
It's really difficult because it's that back knee as well. Which is
I think it comes down to how developed your quads are.
My quads?
Yeah, your quads.
Quads.
Because the thing is, if you really look at the mechanism of the lunges, it's your quads that is using a lot of extension and pushing back. It's a lot of eccentric movement. So that eccentric movement is the one that's causing a lot of pain and overuse and fatigue. So with that extra lunges, like, you are on the outside of the foot. It means that you have more stress on the lateral side of your knee, which is your hamstring. So that means if you're going on the side way, you will have more stress on the outside. Your, what's that, the vastus VM.
Mm-hmm.
So then when you try to push up, it's at the back. It's your hamstring that's pushing back.
Like to understand that, but I'm actually throwing out that the way we lunge is pretty wrong. Big Dad's been starting to do it in a way that's very efficient. Lindan's been doing it for quite some time.
Yeah. In fact, we had a, just back at my uni, we had a, a very, very much biomechanic kind of analyzing of how it's being done when we compare it with fencing. You know that how people do the fencing, they are also looking forward, but they are not as much as going so deep down as compared to badminton or squash, because they will go full lunge up. So then if you're going on the side way, it will be a lot more stress on the outside of the hip. But because a lot of them, if you are really going directional towards the side, you won't open up with that.
See, it's good.
You won't open up like
that. What I think the whole problem.
You will not. You will be going forward the body instead. You see, you'll be going towards the direction instead of doing like this.
Yeah. So that's what I'm saying. Like, if it's changed, if you watch one or two of the best movements in our sport, they do something very different. So this is what we're taught as youngsters to slow down, decelerate with this leg, and come up. If you're watching the modern way of doing it, they're actually
doing
this,
yeah.
and then they don't have to do
that extra push.
This,
yeah.
So then the lateral side is not actually activated as
yeah.
much.
So
it's more balanced.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a little debate on this. So we will depend. It will have to depend on what's the level of the player is. Like if Lee Chong-wei, he did, we had a little bit look at his quad strength. He wasn't doing a lot of squats earlier on. That's the reason why they added squats for him. That's why he had to do drop squats to strengthen his leg going forward to push back. And it's evident that he became much faster when he is going forward than pushing backwards slowly.
Yeah, that's
I can't comment on that, and I'm not even going to begin to because I think that's just.
But
I think the take home for me is I actually think the most important muscle is your glute med, which is your muscle that opens up your knee. So regardless of what your foot position is, if you're here and your knee is there, then that's a disaster.
That's
and if your knee is there, then that's a disaster. But if you can actually open out whatever position you decide in, maximising that opening so your knee is in line with your foot, I think would be what I would recommend from where I am. But again, no bad internet school. Change of direction, I think this is interesting. I don't know how you do it. It's probably more... When you change direction, you need to plant your outside foot in the wall, right? So you're going up here, planting your outside foot, and when you're coming back the other way, you're actually wanting to be driving off your inside leg. So it's the idea of you having a brake and an accelerator. So you have brake here, but to get back to this position, you don't want to be doing that and then coming back that way. So what we're teaching people is to land, but to shift their weight to the inside leg to drive off for the next movement. And the way to do that, I'll try and show you later, but it's just the idea of when you're changing direction, ideally you don't want a really wide foot stance position.
That's exactly what I'm talking about there, because most badminton players have a large...
Yes, but I think that's partly the requirement of the sport as well in terms to keep balance and centred, so I don't quite know the answer to that. I can see it's a high risk movement. I just wanted to show you here. This is an example of takeoff. So the left knee, yes, and I imagine it's a weight shift thing in terms of where it needs to be. You see how the knee actually now turns in. Yeah, you can see it kind of valgus knee, a little bit of takeoff. So ideally, that's something that you want to be looking for. And again, I imagine that is probably something that you need to be doing in terms of weight shift. Is the guy at the back here, I'm just interested in terms of how he's landing. He's landing quite well. And so say that there's so many multiple lands. How many lands do you do in a game? It's ridiculous. But even though, see that leg is starting to come out, look at that there, but the knee alignment is okay in terms of that position. See, it's really still quite okay. And then this last one as well. Just think, he was, to me, thought, okay, it's a high risk movement, but he's actually doing it as well as he probably could. And then this last one is a change of direction, again, where the knee, it's just this very next movement, so you need to watch quickly, but it's the push off that right leg, it actually looks to be in quite good alignment. So it's a wide position, which I know is risk, but the knee is actually pretty well placed. And same as next one, as opposed to having the valgus knee. I don't know if you see that in your players, but we definitely see that in netball, which is why I spend a fair bit of time trying to actually get that. I'm almost done with this, we'll go on to court movement. Sorry, it's taken a while. So there are four sections to this warm-up. So the key principles, takeoff, landing, change of direction, deceleration, and there are four sections to it. So warm-up, which is to kind of actually switch the brain on. One of the coaches here, which I really agree with, is, you know, you go through your warm-up and you're chatting about what's on Twitter or whatever, you stop the talk and you actually switch on and you actually try and switch your brain on for what's about to happen. Strength, we predominantly work on muscles to control the hips, so it's glute, it's quads, but it's more glute for us. It's glute and calf and hamstring to kind of improve that landing. Balance and landing, a lot of work on how to land safely, to land when it's safe, you know, in a safe position, but to land efficiently as well, and with knocks and all sorts of things, which I'll show you. And the agility section, which really tries to enhance their footwork and deceleration, change of direction. We always try to use the ball as much as possible because it's that overhead arm position, which, you know, it's pretty relevant for you guys too. If you are to do the program with your players, it's really important that you give them feedback as to what they're doing right and what they're doing wrong, because otherwise you're just reinforcing poor technique. Really important with that. I have done this in the manual, you'll see internal, you'll have players' points and coaches' points, and it's really just to try and ensure if you're giving feedback and you're selling someone, you want them to bend their knees, but if you actually tell them to bend their knees, it's actually worse for them in terms of processing than telling them to actually sit back into a chair. So, and internal feedback is bend your knees when you land. External feedback focuses on what happens. Sit back into a chair. It's an external cue. I tell the players, sit back like you're hovering over a public toilet seat. It's that kind of real low position. They all get it straight away, and it improves it dramatically. But if you tell them to bend their knees, as opposed to an external cue, the external cues give you a faster and more efficient acquisition of skill. So it's a subtle difference, but it really does work. The other thing we do with footwork is we line our feet up with the floorboards on the ground. So I don't know how you do that, but just some ideas in terms of that. The other major thing with this is that you need to continue doing it. So if you stop doing it, the effects actually evaporate in a puff of smoke. So to be effective, it needs to be continued and it needs to be done at least a couple of times a week. Otherwise, if you've done your ACL or your knee injury prevention program, you stop it and you're covered.
Space, time, recommend.
Doesn't matter, it's 2 to 3 times a week, and it shouldn't take more than about 10 to 12 minutes to do. It's a lot of content in the program. You just select exercises here or there. How long would your warm up take usually for badminton?
I just do that too.
I don't know what you do, okay, second last slide, I think. The key things, the main way that these programs don't work is in getting people to do it. So we've really tried hard to enhance that as much as possible. And they've been a warm-up, so it's just incorporated into training. You then forget about it. It allows people that are playing for different teams or different groups to do it wherever they are. The digital resource is really important, so that those who like smartphones can just use it on the phone. If you're a coach, what was that again? It's right there in front of you. Or you can have a big app if you like. And for me, I made it relevant. I actually got the buy-in from players and changed things by a few things that they didn't like. Went to coaches, what do you like, what don't you like? And I've really tried to make it relevant. That's an example of someone doing it wrong. But I think what we might do, in the interests of time, is have a little play with some of the exercises and see what we can do. What do you think?
Yes.
Yeah? Okay, sure.